Hey guys, Captain Fraser here. I am in London, England, my native England, and I'm bringing you today a podcast where I had the pleasure of sitting down with Jeff Maggio, a real long-term legend guide in Fort Lauderdale and Miami area. And he interviewed me about how I came from here, from England, all the way to Florida, and made it as a sport fish captain as my career. You guys, no fishing this time, just the podcast, hear my story, learn a little bit about how I made it on a sport fish, how I made it a career, and from this cold English weather to the beautiful Florida tropical sunshine. Find out more and learn more about my story and how I did it right after this.
Fraser Simpson today, fly fishing with Fraser.
Okay, flying fish with Fraser.
Flying fish with Fraser. That's the, that's a great website name.
Yeah, well, when I got into it, I wanted to do a little bit of a niche because it seemed like there was some other guys doing the fishing there in North Miami, Biscayne Bay, doing night charters for tarpon and so on. And I kind of wanted to do something. It was just a little bit, didn't want to step on anybody's toes. So I kind of went in the fly fishing route. There seemed to be less of those guys at night doing that stuff. So.
Yeah, there's not too many of the fly fishing crowd, but the I don't know if it's just because I want to do it a little bit more, but it seems to me like in the last couple 3 years I'm seeing a little bit more momentum in the fly fishing part of our business.
Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah,
the few guys out there I've seen. Bob LeMay was a big one for me, a big influence when I first started.
You know,
he was out there quite a bit. I haven't seen him so much lately. But.
Well, I remember you asked me if I heard from him or seen him or anything, and I did. But I was thinking about you a couple of days ago. I'm fishing with Jody Moore down on the beach, doing a fly fishing for snooks. And your old dog, Bob LeMay, spoke at the SOB Club last Thursday. I got the full update on him, and... Bob's getting up there.
Yeah.
You know, he's not doing the trips. He's kind of slowed way down. But I remember when I first met you, that Bob was a big influence on you.
Yeah. We used to speak probably like at least twice a month and then kind of do like a, I don't know, like a 45 minutes, sometimes even up to an hour, just chatting all about nighttime fishing on fly and all different techniques and what we've been seeing and how's he doing it. And that was great for the first, I think it was the first couple of years.
Yeah.
And, you know, I could get somebody for the day trips in the Everglades that passed along to him. And in return, you know, he'd give me some good advice around Miami, so.
Well, Bob, I'm not really good friends with Bob, but he used to refer to me. He's always been helpful when I did see him. And so when you told me that you had that relationship with him, I wasn't too, you know, surprised by it. That was kind of cool. But I want to go way back because you're the reason I wanted you to come into the podcast, and I've known Fraser. Come on, we know each other now.
Wow. It was like 2000. I mean, I remember seeing you around New River and when you started doing your videos around 2005, 2006, 2007 when it was like
So we've known each other.
Spot stealing and
well over 15 years, and. Fraser is the story that everybody thinks their dream is, which is why I wanted to come in the studio that one day and I wanted you guys to meet him and hear his story. Because I don't know if this happens to you, Fraser, but people reach out to me constantly and they want to know if they should start being a guy or a captain, or I want to work on a boat, or how do I get started in the industry. And so I want you to take us back. I know the story, but the audience does. I want you to take us back all the way to the beginning, which your old man introduced you to the water. Because you and I are both fortunate that we had a role model like that to put us in that direction. And the guys that call and that are interested that didn't have that, what do you tell them? Like, you can't replace it. So I want you to kind of really... dig deep a little bit and start from the beginning.
Yeah, well, I was really lucky because, well, I was born in England, and my father was really into fishing, and I guess from an early age, like less than a year old, he had his own boat, and he was working in the oil business in offshore oil drilling on the platforms out in the North Sea in England.
Look, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and he used to make his own homemade jigs off on the rigs. They'd get copper pipes, polish them up, fill them with lead with a like a coat hanger through wire and a treble hook at the end, polish them up and be fishing off the rigs, you know, dropping jigs down a couple hundred feet and be catching cod in the North Sea. And they'd come home with a whole bunch of fish, and then I was real lucky because he got me into it, and on the weekends, I can remember a little bit from being that early age, but he used to take me out, he'd be shark fishing, and he had a few light tackle records on like 10-pound test with sharks.
And where was he? And where was he taking you? What part of the ocean?
Well, at that time, that was in off of Ireland, off of Cork, a place called Cork, and he had, was way back in the day. I was probably by then, it was 3 or 4, so, and I'd be catching mackerel on a sabiki, and he'd be chop them up, and then we'd put them out as bait. But I can remember he'd lock me in the cabin, and back in those days, the only good shark was a dead shark, you know, so, I mean, for records and stuff, he'd pull them in and beat them. I'd be in the cabin looking through the keyhole. And,
well, as far as I'm concerned, even to this day, the only good shark is a dead shark. I think them bastards.
Yeah, that's a whole other story. But yeah, so I kind of got into it early. And even on the freshwater side, you know, he'd get me up at 4 or 5 in the morning. We'd go out into the lakes on a little freshwater boat. We'd be catching carp and roach and tench, all those cold water English fish. And we'd be using floats and little maggots as bait and chumming. And I remember the first tench I got, and I remember that fish, and we were on a little dock into the middle of the lake, and you know, I saw the bubbles come up around the float, then the float went under, and when I was fighting that fish, and it went on around the dock and kind of around the piling, and I was pulled it out, I managed to get it out of there, and that was like, wow, it blew my mind, you know, a little sport to it, and that fish was so cool. It was just like the best thing ever. And after that, I was hooked. That was it. That fish really got me into it. And I was, 6, 7, 8 years old.
Right.
And then ever since then, you know, you kind of go into the bass fishing and everything. Well, take a step back. We moved from England. My parents got into the scuba diving business.
Yeah, that's what I want to hear, because not only, like, very similar, not only did my father introduce me to fishing and the sport of it and all, but he was in the business of building sport fishing boats. And your dad was in the business of what, scuba?
Yeah, yeah. So he was in the oil business, didn't want to be offshore anymore, and he was gone, you know, on 3 weeks and off a week and then on. So anyway, he decided to do the American dream and move to Florida and start a scuba diving shop. And we actually, first one was on Lake Worth Road, Federal, and it was a little shop and a little boat, a little Parker 21 with the cutting cabin, and they started doing trip. You know, my mother ran the shop, and my dad would sometimes drive the boat, or vice versa. My mother is a scuba diving instructor as well as my father, so they would take turns, ran the business hands on for doing 15-hour days when they started, 18-hour days. So yeah, that's how I got over here, and then from there, I kind of got into, just like any other kid, I was in elementary school then, got into bass fishing and then saltwater fishing. But yeah, the dive shop kind of got into a whole other story in the 80s. That shop was definitely an eye-opener, because at that time, in the 80s, there was a whole, as you know, an influx of drug running going on.
Yeah.
And this is probably one of the most interesting times of my life. At that time, we had
this was happening in the name beside the dance. How bad a bit. Now it's easy enough to deal with it.
Yeah.
What happens?
So, you can start it with, so because of the drug run.
So yeah, because of the drug run, at the time we didn't really know it, but there was a lot of guys we could frequent in our shop, and they all had huge cigarette boats that you'd like, so you'd never see. I mean, cash, all the latest electronics. Back in those days, it was just Loran, some radar. But these boats were super fast and built, you know, I mean, they were pretty amazing. They'd pull up to our shop. They'd come in and be like, oh, I want, 10 spears, you know, a couple spear guns and all my tanks and equipment. They'd drop a huge amount of money in the shop. My dad was, wow, you know. And there was about 5 or 6 guys like that. And they said they were all going over. Well, you know, I mean, they ask them, but of course they go over the Bahamas and they come back with these huge groupers. I mean, Nassau grouper, black groupers. I mean, 5s, 10s, just pounds of fish. A couple of them were doing like tropical fish for aquariums as well.
Yeah.
And they'd go over there, get tropicals or here too. You don't really know exactly where they're going. We figure it was Bahamas. This is all later we find this out anyway, but these guys come up to the shop, and I remember this, the one gentleman, he comes to the shop and he's got his big cigarette boat there, and he said, he told us, he came clean, he said, you know, I got caught in the Bahamas, and they found some substance on the boat, and they threw him in a foxhole on the beach, the Bahamian police.
Really?
And they put a pallet over the top of the hole. And he said that when the water, the tide came in, he was just up to his neck with his head sticking out of the pallet with his, you know, just breathing air.
Really?
And he said he was terrified. And I guess they didn't form whatever, I don't know how, they couldn't really pin anything on him, so eventually they let him go because they couldn't get the, there was nothing there on his boat, I guess.
Yeah.
Whatever he did with it. So he says, but I tell you what, it's right outside our shop in the middle of the day on Lake Worth and Faro. He goes, I tell you what, I'm never going back there again. And he climbs up on a boat and pulls out 50 caliber machine gun and mounts it on the front. He had a mount made and said he's never going back again. And this guy, I'm just standing there going, holy shit.
No, there was a lot of those dudes in the 80s. Palm Beach to Miami, they would get together on the weekends here in Port Everglades, and they would race from Daniel Bridge to the port. He says it's like one long straightaway. They all hang, like a bunch of Harley people, and they all hang out down there. But you had the corporate dudes, you had the drug dealers, you had the manufacturers, you had guys like your dad who might have been friends with some of these guys who are just having fun on the weekend. But it was such the thing. And people don't realize also that there was basically no enforcement on drugs until Bush Sr. flipped out and came in. And
yeah.
Before Bush Sr.,
yeah,
it was just, you could do whatever you wanted out there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think at that time there was one boat, I mean, they had more money than the government and the Coast Guard put, you know, had that in the budget. At that time, they had the best electronics and everything, boats they could get. But I remember it was a boat named Blue Thunder, and that came out years later. It was the only boat fast enough to catch him. Now, they used to just outrun him. They'd tell us stories. They'd just be like, all right, hammer down, let's go. And they'd just outrun him. Couldn't catch him. And back in those days, they just had helicopter. It wasn't like there was satellites and whatnot, and JWACs and whatnot back then, I guess. So there's a lot of stories of them going over there, doing tropical fish catching. But I guess that spear fishing. But I guess at that time, too, I heard rumors that, you know, those groupers are so big, they just flush out the stomachs and shove all the, you know, the coke or whatever into the stomach of the fish and then just be unloading it in broad daylight. You know, these big fat groupers.
That's funny.
Yeah, there was a few. They all had restaurants and whatnot and, you know, is there. They invited us there, but there was a few people there. But
the amount of money that was laundered was on A1A between Palm Beach and Miami.
West.
You know, over the years, I mean, realistically, it supported the whole economy. for the longest time.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And now it's become corporate and everything. But in those days, it was all about guys laundering money, starting businesses, yeah. doing hotels, all cash. Oh, I miss those days.
For sure. But, yeah.
So then what? Then what happened? Then he went to, but he ended up in Costa Rica.
Yes, yeah.
How did that work?
So, I went through school and finished up with high school and graduated, and they saw another opportunity. They started up a scuba diving shop. Well, we all went over to Europe and did a little European vacation when I graduated. And we went to the Red Sea and went scuba diving there off of Egypt and Sinai Peninsula. And so they went on and started another scuba diving shop out there in the Red Sea, which was kind of put me through college at the time. That's what I wanted to do. Loved the ocean and everything, but just felt like, you know, this was the direction I was going to go in at that time. So, but yeah, Costa Rica, that was fast forward some more years. There was another opportunity down there. I was getting into the fishing and salt water. And I got out of school and was doing sales. And I used to get invited by a mutual friend of ours, Aaron Jones, one of the...
Aaron Jones,
yeah, he was a big sales guy. And he was doing pharmaceutical sales at the time. And I knew him from getting at sales and medical devices and stuff that I was trying to sell and doing that stuff. But he used to charter and take clients out. It's kind of like a, you know, it's a promo and take them out for a good time. And he used to invite me along. So anyway, that was going through school, and I get into salt water, and I just kind of loved it. And I went down to Costa Rica with my father, and we did some fishing in Panama. We thought, man, this place is great, you know. And, you know, we went to, and I said, well, I'll go back and I want to check it out some more from, down there in Jaco, near Jaco.
Mm-hmm.
And I got a little apartment there and started working as, you know, a mate. And my father actually came down later and he got us some property there, a house, and everything.
So you actually opened up the doors in Costa Rica for your dad to come in.
Kind of, yeah.
I didn't realize that.
I was the scout. Yeah, I kind of scouted it out.
Oh, cool.
And kind of put everything together, about bank accounts and whatnot, kind of got established. And then my father came in and he kind of went from there. But all that time I was working on a 32 lures down there, which my father actually had. That was his boat. But he had a Costa Rican captain there named Shanu, really great guy, a lot of knowledge. And I worked with him as the mate, going out pretty much every day when I was there. And after, I guess, the season ended, I'd come back to Florida. But
now, back then, when you're fishing with Shanu, who were you guys targeting? And how much, you know, what kind of work were you doing with him?
So, yeah, we were just, his whole game was sailfish. Okay. And, man, I tell you what, we would put together, his spread. I still run it today. It's awesome. And it would be targeted in sails, naked ballyhoo, swimmers, you know, a little chin weight, with some big teasers up on the bridge, for the occasional marlin with some drop back baits. But it was all bait, pretty much bait and switch all right up next to the boat. The outrigger, the long riggers had, you know, circle hooks in them, but the shorts, we would tease and switch. And then, man, I'd sit on that cover board, and that was my favorite position, just on the teaser, on the squid chain, teasing them up, and then taking them onto the little flat line, mm-hmm. you know, and dropping back. And that, oh man, I could spend all summer doing that, you know.
Yeah,
it was it was the best, man. It was, talk about the high. That was incredible to see the sail come up like that, take a bait. So, and at that time, when the season was done, I'd come back and I'd work a little bit, and I had to, you know, get another job and start working back in South Florida a little bit. But when the season was back on, I'd take Friday nights, take the red eye, like on Spirit from Fort Lauderdale, get back into San Jose at like 2 o'clock in the morning, go straight to the boat, sleep on the boat, get a few monsters and be at it by like 6 o'clock and be fishing all for the next 3 days on a long weekend, you know, work and stuff. And for me, it was kind of the plan because I don't think there's anywhere else, you know, between that's local, couple hours flight, that you can get so many bites and so much experience in a short amount of time with like 15, 20 bites and right. teasing up fish. You can get certainly a ton of knowledge there in a short time. So it didn't take long to get, you know, a lot more experience than you would sit here at ADOC, which I've done. When I first started, I was on ADOC.
Yeah, you spent a little time down there?
Hey. You know, so it's kind of a rite of passage is where we all start.
Well, you got, you know, ADOC is kind of like, I always call it like a university. Whether you spend, you know, one semester there or you spend your whole career there.
Yeah.
People go to ADOC, whether they're yeah. working or they're just there. It's just, it's part of the sheer domain.
Yeah.
And it's a shame that it's gone. But that's another whole story.
That's a whole other story, yeah. But yeah, so... So that lasted, I guess, a good part of 8, 9, 10, almost 10 years, something like that.
So, and what age did you start with Sinew? And learned all that stuff. How old were you?
I think that was 7 and 8, 2007, 8, 9, 10. It's not that long ago, but
no, it's getting to be kind of almost 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. What, 16 years?
12, 13, 14 in there, yeah.
All right. No, because it's it's
trying to
give everybody kind of the scope, because you're a lot younger than most of the guys in your position, put it that way. Most of the guys in your position that you're at that age are still kind of getting the experience that you were able to get 15 years ago, put it that way.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, not too often the captains get a chance to work with somebody like the guy in Costa Rica, put in that type of work, and then get rewarded for it, and then you understand the whole process of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, like working down on ADOC or whatever, you know, your reward was if you could get somebody to mount fish.
Yeah.
And that kind of thing.
Yeah, it didn't take long to kind of figure out that I needed to make it. It wasn't easy, a significant jump. I mean, I had to come back and my first attempt, you know, like before my father got started down there, it was, you know, it wasn't easy, I'll tell you that. But
a lot of bumps and bruises along the way, huh?
Yeah, but definitely worth it. In the end, you know, I wasn't making a ton of money, but I knew the experience was well worth it. It was going to pay off. It's just like anything else. You got to go to college. Or you gotta put the time in, as they say in this business, we gotta put some time in.
Well, Captain Norm says, you gotta put in your dues.
That's it, you know.
So, did Captain Norm go home on the end of that?
Yeah, I did.
That's everybody's still celebrating from that.
That's awesome.
It's good shit.
I mean, going out there and targeting it too.
I guess that was, we're all happy about that. That's like, you know, hitting the home run in your own, you know, ball field, and all the locals are pretty freaking out.
Heck yeah.
You know?
Heck yeah.
But anyway, go ahead, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Where should we start off next?
I want the audience to understand. Well, dude, you're working on a 90-foot, $20 million boat.
Yeah.
You went from fucking being with Sinew in an industry that you never were in before, and now you're on the 100-foot boat and you fly fish for tarpon at the same time. So, you got a lot of shit to go over here, Frazier.
Yeah, so how did all this go about? Yeah. So I quietly kind of, once I came back from Costa Rica, I quietly started working on sport fish and the first one was a 46. I met a guy down in Costa Rica, and a good friend of mine still to this day, kind of like my first client. And he asked me when I was down there, he's like, hey, you know, can you take my boat down to, from Tampa all the way down to St. Thomas, the Virgin Islands? So I was like, yeah, sure, no problem. And so he was really like first sport fish kind of introduction, so to speak, you know, as far as running the shows going international. So I took that boat down into Tampa across Lake Okeechobee and the canal there, and all the way down through Bahamas and Dominican Republic. That's a whole bad. Hey everybody, if you like this video, go ahead, hit the subscribe button to follow along with more fishing and adventures. And of course, give us a thumbs up. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for watching.
Hey guys, if you want to hear more about getting into the sport fish community, becoming a sport fish captain, or anything of the following, becoming a guide, go ahead and comment below. Thanks so much.